I'm Nancy Cutler, president of the board of the Jewish Museum of Maryland. And it's my pleasure this afternoon to welcome you to our virtual program entitled Diving into History, the Historic Mikva’ot of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. Our presentation today continues our celebration of the 175th anniversary of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. For those of you who have missed the two programs already presented in this series, please use the links that we will share in the chat box at the end of the program to view the other recordings in full. And with that, I'd like to introduce our speaker. Wendy Davis is a lifelong Baltimorean and an active member of Chesed Emunah congregation. She was introduced to the museum many years ago by her parents, Phyllis and Gordon Salganik, who are active supporters of the museum. In 2012, it was her turn to contribute to the Jewish Museum. While winding down her career as a speech and language pathologist and working part-time for Baltimore City Public School System, Wendy became a docent for the Jewish Museum, a perfect fit for her since she loves history and meeting new people. And she has since retired from the school system and is now busy with her retirement gig as the Jewish Museum's volunteer coordinator. Just on a personal note, and as a docent myself for the museum, I just want to add how grateful we are to have somebody like Wendy as our volunteer coordinator. She does an incredible job of training, managing, and motivating volunteers at the museum. So thank you, Wendy, for that. And now I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you, Nancy, very much for that warm welcome. And welcome everybody to the program this afternoon. Now, at the Jewish Museum of Maryland, we are storytellers. And our story today is about the four mikvaot that were located at the Lloyd Street Synagogue. So when visitors come, let me start the story now. When visitors come to the Jewish Museum of Maryland, I love to take them to into the Lloyd Street Synagogue, our most precious artifact. And when we go into the, come on screen share, let's work. Okay, we go into the sanctuary of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. And in the center, we see the 20th century Bima, the raised platform where the Torah, the five books of the Bible are read on the holidays and on the Sabbath. And then in front of it on the far eastern wall, we see the Ark, the cabinet where the Torah is kept. It's in the style of Greek Revival, and it is a replica of the 1860 Ark that was located in the building. And above that is a beautiful stained glass window. It's an image of the Star of David. It was original to the 1845 building when it was originally built. And we believe it's the oldest known example of when the star is being used as an architectural feature in America. And it's not unusual when I take people into the space that I have a visitor who says, "Do you have a mikveh here? Can we see it?" And of course, the answer to both of those is yes. So we go down to the basement, and this is what we see. This is the fourth of the four mikveh, the last of the four mikvaot built at the Lloyd Street Synagogue site. So then we have people who are looking at it and say, okay, but what is a mikveh? You know, they see in front of them this basin in the ground lined with white tile with brown tile trim. But what is it? The literal translation for a mikveh is, it's a gathering of water for ritual immersion. And mikvaot, by the way, is plural for mikveh, have been used by Jews since ancient times, though the custom is not as widespread today as it used to be. But the use of the mikveh was so integral into the way of life for the early Jews in America. Many times, the congregations built their mikveh before they built their synagogue building. And often these mikvaot were found in homes, private homes. And if any of you were fortunate enough to join the museum this summer for their program, Jewish Museums Across the Seas, you would have learned that the Jewish Museum in London has a medieval mikvah in their collection that was originally found in a private home. But let's get back onto this side of the ocean. So we're talking about the early mikvah in America. Unfortunately, historians have been unable to locate these early mikvah, but the oldest known archaeologically documented mikvah complex in North America is just a few feet away from the mikvah you see pictured here at the site of the Lloyd Street Synagogue, and it dates back to 1845. But for 100 years, congregants, just as they modified the sanctuary, they have modified the mikvah complex. So before we delve into the history of the multiple mikvahot at the Lloyd Street Synagogue, let's learn a little bit more about the characteristics of a mikvah. So why do people immerse in a mikvah? Jewish law mandates various uses, including if someone is converting to Judaism, the last stage in conversion is going to the mikvah. Before getting married, women go to a mikvah. And after women have their periods, their monthly cycles, they're supposed to go to the mikvah so they can be pure for the marital bed. But the symbolism of the mikvah water has inspired others to use it to mark transitions. These are non-Jewish law reasons, non-halakha reasons. So what are some of them? Men in various communities immerse every day, usually before daily prayers. People go to the mikvah Friday before the Sabbath or before Yom Kippur to prepare themselves for those special days. Men are known to use the mikvah before getting married. And recently I've heard of people who go to the mikvah after they recover from a serious illness, and sometimes after they are granted divorce to just mark a new transition in their life. So what do mikvahs require? Well, they first must be built permanently into the ground, making them an integral part of the earth. So if you've ever looked in a mikvah, you'll notice there's no drain in a mikvah, because if there was, it would no longer be an integral part of the earth. The mikvah must be large enough to complete immersion in one act. And they must contain at least 40 se'ah of natural water. So this statement might bring to mind two questions. The first is, what are 40 se'ah? Well, we're not sure exactly, but I've read various opinions that it can be between 150 and 200 gallons. Though most authorities that I've read are leaning more towards the 200 gallon mark. And then the next question is, what is natural water? It can also be described as live water. Well, I'd like to see what you think. Let's take a poll and find out.
Hello, everyone. So if you've joined us for some of our previous programs, you know that we sometimes enjoy quizzing the audience on their knowledge. So I'm going to go ahead and launch a poll that should pop up on your screen shortly. And the question is, which of the following is considered live water? A, rainwater, B, streams, C, snow, D, ice, or E, all of the above. So you can go ahead and vote by just clicking the button that you think is the answer to which of the following is considered live water. And I'll go ahead and give everyone just a couple more seconds before I end it. All right, get your last minute votes in. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and end it. And we have a very knowledgeable audience. Almost everyone, majority, 78% said E, all of the above, with the second answer being rainwater. Is E correct, Wendy?
Well, let's find out. Let's see what the natural water sources are. Rainwater is a natural water source. So are streams, things that can include bodies of water that flow, such as rivers, lakes, oceans. It can be snow, and we've got plenty today to use if we need it. And it can also be ice. So everybody who clicked off E, you're correct. Well done, well done. Well, this natural water doesn't go directly into the mikveh that's used for immersion. It goes into a storage reservoir. In Hebrew, it's called a bor. And the bor must be large enough to hold at least 40 seah of water. And it's usually not used for immersion. And pictured on the screen, we have the 20th century bor that was built at the museum, at the Lloyd Street Synagogue. And you can see it, like the mikveh I showed earlier, is lined with white tile. But what I'd like you to look at is this pipe right here near the top of the water line. I'm going to talk about that in a moment. So here, the similar picture that I showed near the beginning is the ritual pool. In Hebrew, it's called tevela. And this is traditional. It has seven steps down. This ritual pool can be filled with water from any source whatsoever and can be emptied and filled for hygienic purposes. So then the question is, what makes this water ritually pure? Well, remember that pipe I showed you in the bor? There's the other end of the pipe is located right here. It's off the screen. It's by the bottom off the screen. And when the mikveh, the tevela, and the bor are filled with water, when it gets near the top, all of a sudden the water starts mingling between the pipes, between both cavities. And when they mingle, this is called kissing. And when the water comes together, now the water in the tevela is ritually pure. Now let's dive into history. We're gonna go backwards in history, talking about the most current congregation and then backwards to the first congregation in the building. Here we have a picture of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. It fronts on Lloyd Street. The side is on Watson Street. This picture was taken, I believe, in 1910. And the congregation pictured is Shomri Mishmeres HaKodesh. This congregation was formed in 1890 by a group of Jews from Eastern Europe. They were a bastion of traditional Judaism. And they moved into this building 13 years after they're established in 1905. They stayed here through the 50s. The congregation that was in the building before them was St. John the Baptist Lithuanian Catholic Church. Yes, it was not a synagogue. And they were in this building for 15 years from 1889 to 1905. And previous to their occupation was Netke Israel, which translates as Baltimore Hebrew Congregation. Scattered of Israel. And they were also called Baltimore Hebrew Congregation. And those from Baltimore are thinking, is it related to the congregation that's on Park Heights Avenue at the city line? Yes, it is. It's the same congregation that exists today. Now, this congregation was formed in 1830 by a group of Jews who came from German-speaking countries. And they built the synagogue 15 years after they're established in 1845. This is the fifth purpose-built synagogue in the United States. This congregation they strictly adhered to the traditions. They followed rabbinic law, but as the years progressed, traditions started being shed. So we have to keep that in mind when I start telling the story about the Mikva’ot. When this building was built in 1845, it was about 28 feet shorter than it is today. So when Baltimore Hebrew bought the property, the congregation had about 61 family members, and the property they bought was 3.25 acres. And we know that on the property, there was a building that was built in 1835. Now here you can see a plan in black and white of the 1845 building, and screened in red is the addition that was put on in 1860. And you can see overlapping this addition is an outline of a house. Now we know that it was reported in the Baltimore American and Commercial Daily Advertisers in September of 1845. It quotes, "In the rear of the church," which they really mean synagogue, "a building has been erected for a dwelling, and it contains a room fitted up for the purpose of religious ablution." So this was what we call the mikveh house. And we're not sure if the 1835 building was modified to accommodate the mikveh or a new building was built. There's no documentation to prove one way or the other. As I was doing research for this project, I came across this picture. It was taken not that long ago in 1964 at the dedication of the Lloyd Street Synagogue after it was restored by the Jewish Historical Society of Maryland, which is the predecessor for the Jewish Museum of Maryland. And pictured here, we have one of the speakers standing next to his wife. Do you know who the speaker is? Let's take a poll and find out.
Yes, it's time for another poll. So I'll go ahead and launch that right now. It should be popping up on your screen. The question is, the man depicted in this picture spoke at the 1964 rededication of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. What is his name? A, Israel Goldman, B, Theodore McKeldin, C, Samuel Rosenblatt, or D, Thomas D'Alessandro Jr. All right, this one I think is a bit tougher. We're not seeing as much consensus on this one. Let's see, I'll give it another minute. Ooh, none of the answers have 50% yet. That's interesting. All right. One more minute. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and end it. And we actually have a tie with 45% of people saying B, Theodore McKeldin, and 45% also saying D, Thomas D'Alessandro Jr. Who's right, Wendy?
Well, if you chose the mayor of the city, you're correct in that part. This mayor is Thomas D'Alessandro, and he's standing with his wife, Honolulu. But what really drew me to this picture was, it's McKeldin, and I jumped ahead, wrong screen. It's Theodore McKeldin, I apologize. Anyway, what drew me to the screen was the houses that are across the street from where the mayor's standing. Now, these houses are typical Baltimore row houses, and it's very possible that they were standing at the same time that the mikveh house was across the street from them. So it gives us an idea of what the house, mikveh house, might have looked like. Typical of Baltimore homes, they're made out of brick. They're no wider than 14 feet. We can see two of them have a pitch roof and one beyond it has a flat roof. Now these buildings are no longer standing. They've been torn down to make way for the Jewish Museum offices and exhibition space. I also want to let you know what we know about the mikveh house. Most of what we know comes from the minutes of the Baltimore Hebrew congregation. We learn from the minutes that women maintain the mikveh, and they also use the house as their dwelling, which we heard about when I was talking about the advertiser. We know that the women rented the house for a term of 1 year, and the women collected fees for the use of the mikveh, which they applied to the rent. So you might now think, okay, how much do they pay per rent? Well, Mrs. Berliner, whose tenure started in 1856, she paid $150 per year, plus the expense of the gas. She, a year before she moved in, gas was put in the house. We know the gas was used for lighting in the house, and it's very possible it was also used to heat the water for the mikvah. Now, we also know from the minutes that in 1852, the base of the mikvah was entirely rotten. So we can assume that it was made out of wood. We've also learned that Mrs. Jacoby, who was a mikvah keeper, left in the fall of 1852. And the next mikvah keeper didn't come in until 1855, when the mikvah was framed with wood and then lined with marble. Well, the mikvah house was raised in 1860 to make way for the new addition to the Lloyd Street Synagogue. So to find out more about the mikvah, the archaeologists need to dig in the basement of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. And here we see them in a dig in 2001. And you can see they're adjacent to the mikvah that I showed earlier. Now, here's another picture of the hole that the archaeologists were in. And just to give you bearings, the existing mikvah is right over here, the 20th century mikvah. So in this hole, we have Esther Doyle Reed, who is one of the archaeologists. And I mention her because about 7 years ago, I was taking a group of visitors through the Lloyd Street Synagogue, and she was among the visitors. So when we got to the mikvah area, I asked her to help tell what she knew about the mikvah. So the things that she told me, I'm including in my talk today. So what did the archaeologists find during this dig in 2001? They found the western foundation of the mikvah house. They found a fire hearth. Now we know in the minutes of May 1852, water for the mikvah was heated in a kettle in the mikvah house. Now we know it was probably close to the mikvah itself, number one, for the warmth and comfort of the user, and two, for the convenience of the mikvah keeper. So where is the mikvah? Well, the archaeologists at this point were believing it was right behind where Esther is sitting, because they found wood there. It's a possible edge of the mikvah. But they needed to consult experts on wood preservation, so they decided to leave the excavation of that part of the site to a future date. So let's jump ahead to 2008. At this time, the Jewish Museum of Maryland undertook the restoration and repair of parts of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. And one of the projects they were working on was addressing the settlement in the southwest corner of the building. And let's enlarge this picture so you can see better. I drew a red line so you can see the amount of settlement that was occurring. And the arrow is pointing to an area where the mortar is cracking. Also in the interior, the plaster is also cracking. Now, groundwater was suspected, which makes sense because a half a block away is Central Avenue, which was once a creek, Harford Run. And when the road was built, the creek went into a conduit underneath the road. Also, the site of the old row house, which, you know, where the mikvah was, remember that's under this corner where the building's sinking. The area where the row house was built was marsh before the development took place. But this is an historic building. You need architects to come and explore the area before any work is done. So the archaeologists came and they dug in an area directly behind the building in a little alleyway, right back here adjacent to the corner. So here we have one of the archaeologists standing in the hole that they dug adjacent to the building. You can see the stone wall of the foundation. And at the foot was a cavity that they found. Now, none of the archaeologists wanted to go into that cavity because it was directly under this big stone building. So to find out what was there, they put in a camera. And what did they see? They saw a brick cistern. In Hebrew, it's called a dut. they later determined that this was the storage reservoir for the 1845 mikvah. Now, this reservoir was filled with 4 feet of water, and when it was emptied out, this is the picture that they were able to see. The reservoir of the Dut is approximately 5 feet in diameter, including this single course of brick lining, and it was 8 feet deep. And later on, the archaeologists determined that this cistern was located in a semi-finished room in the front of the mikveh house. Here's another view of the cistern, and you can see there the brick is collapsing in this area, and there's one other area where it was collapsing. And they were determined that these were the openings for wooden pipes, wooden drains that either collected the water via a downspout from the roof of the mikveh, or it dispersed the water into the immersion pool. Also, groundwater, we realized, would also seep through the unmortared brick that was there. And that also is live water, remember. Now, Avi Decker, who was the director of the Jewish Museum at the time of this dig, was quoted saying, "The week we discovered the cistern, there was an article in a professional archaeology magazine about the excavation of a 1723 synagogue in Amsterdam. And it had the same three elements. The bath, the cistern, and the hearth where a kettle of water was heated for the mikveh." Now, similar mikveh complexes have been found in Germany and the Netherlands dating back to at least the 1500s. So now we have to think about who built this cistern and this mikveh. They were people from the German-speaking countries. It makes sense for them to build a mikveh complex similar to what they knew of in the old country. Now, do you remember why the archaeologists came to the site to dig? Was to address the settlement of the building. So what was done was grout was injected into the ground under the corner of the building to stabilize it. And the dut, the cistern, was also filled with grout to further halt settlement. And they believed this was the least invasive way to stabilize the foundation. Now, a year later, the archaeologists came into the basement of the Lloyd Street Synagogue to do further digging. And here we have one of the archaeologists standing on the floor of the mikveh house, which is about 3 feet below the current floor level of the basement of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. And what is he looking at? He's looking at the mikveh, the oldest archaeologically documented mikveh in the United States that dates back to the 1845 mikveh house that was built on the Lloyd Street Synagogue site. Now, Esther is standing in the mikveh itself. It was originally about 5 feet deep and 6 feet wide. Now, they did not find the marble that was lining the mikveh, but they did find some marble fragments. So the question is, what happened to the marble that lined the mikveh? Well, remember, the lining was put in 1855. That's just 5 years before the building was raised to make way for the new addition to the synagogue. So it's possible that the marble was used to line the 1860 mikveh. We're not sure, but it's a strong possibility. So here's a drawing of the 1860 addition. We know that the addition lengthened the sanctuary upstairs by 22 and a half feet. Plus there was a 3.5 foot apse put on the eastern wall. The addition in the basement was divided into three segments. The northern segment was the furnace room. The southern segment was a secretary's office and boardroom. And if any of you have been lucky enough to go on a tour of the synagogue building, you might remember that there was a safe in the basement in a room that just seemed like a small walkway. Well, it was originally the secretary's office. So now you know it makes sense to have the safe in that area. And in the middle of this new addition were the mikvah rooms. The mikvah rooms took about 40% of the space here. And each of these three sections had their own exterior doors. There was no way to walk in between those sections, you know, interiorly, and you also could not access the main synagogue building without going to the exterior. So let's look further in the mikvah complex. The door of the mikvah was built into the apse. And I have a picture here that I took recently of the exterior of the building. You can see where the doorway was, and it's now filled in with concrete brick. But archaeologists determined that there were a few stone steps built into the thickness of the wall. And then just below that was a wood landing, which led then one step down to the brick floor of the mikveh complex. We know that there was a changing room in this complex, but there was no evidence of the mikveh bor. They're not sure where it was. But remember the dut that was in the 1845 house? It was covered over with a huge granite slab, which was intended to be a structural support for the building. But the dut itself was not filled in, whereas the rest of the 1845 house was. So that leads us to think that maybe the dut was used as the water storage reservoir for the 1860 mikveh. Now that's only a theory, but it's something to consider. Now the question now is, where was the mikveh, the pool for immersion? It's most likely where the 20th century bor is located. And we think that because the bor was built on top of an older, deeper excavation. Now, remember we were talking earlier about the women who maintained the mikvahs? We know that Mrs. Berliner continued as the mikveh keeper when this addition was put on. We also know from the minutes that she had to agree to not open the mikveh except according to rabbinic law, that female members of the congregation had preference over congregants from other synagogues, and that a committee visited periodically to ensure that she was following these rules. Now, who used these early mikvahot? We know that in 1845 to 1867, women used it during the evening and men used it during the day. After 1867, women continued to use the mikveh, but the only men allowed to use the mikveh were officers of the congregation, and they were allowed to use it only before the holidays. But by February of 1873, we know that a joint effort of the Orthodox community began to maintain the mikveh. So the question is why? Well, we know by the 1860s, congregants started to shed many rituals. We also know that those who wanted to maintain the rituals left to form a new synagogue in 1870. They formed the synagogue Chizakomona. And we also know that there was a huge demographic shift occurring at this time. Many of the congregants are leaving the area where they were living. It was starter homes, and they're moving to nicer quarters, too far to easily access the synagogue. You know, the membership before the congregants started a new shul was that was in 1870 was 165 families. By 1874, it was down to 61 families. And then by 1884, there were only 48 families. And by the end of the 1880s, the congregation decides they're going to move to where their previous congregants were living, which makes way for the church to move in, St. John the Baptist Lithuanian Catholic Church. Now, we have no documentation on how the church used the mikveh area, but they're clues on how the space was used, because grime that was found underneath the concrete floor that was installed by Shlomi Mishmeres HaKodesh, the amount of grime there indicates that the area was rarely cleaned as compared to the rest of the building, which suggests that St. John the Baptist used the area for storage. Then in 1905, Shlomi Mishmeres HaKodesh, which means Watches of the Holy Sanctuary, they move into the building. But a year before they move in, there was a monumental event in Baltimore. There was the 1904 fire. And one of the good things that came out of this fire was that the city installs water and sewage pipes. And Shlomi Mishmeres is able to utilize these pipes when they reconfigure the mikveh space. We know that the congregation changes the entrance. They're now using the entrance that was originally used for the furnace area and the old entrance to the mikveh in the app area, we now believe was used as a fuel storage area, because archaeologists found layers of coal dust impregnated with fuel oil covering the brick floor. The bore, they built a new bore. Remember, we believe they built it on top of where the 1860 mikveh was. And they added a new mikveh, and I have it pictured here. Again, it's white tile, and this time it has blue Art Deco tile trim. And archaeologists were able to date this tile to the early 1900s. Now, adjacent to this mikveh, Shlomi Mishmeres also installed changing stalls. And in these changing stalls, they were able to put in bathtubs. But bathtubs similar to these were pictured in Sears Roebuck mail order catalogs that dated back to the first decade of the 1900s. So we know the bathtubs are contemporary to the mikveh I just showed you. So now some of you were thinking, why do the people of the mikvehs need bathtubs? They're about to immerse in a pool of water. Well, if you're going to use the mikveh for Jewish law reasons, you're required to be totally clean. You have to take off all your jewelry, all the makeup, you know, cut your nails, wash your body, wash your hair. There should be nothing physical between your skin and the water of the mikveh. Now, these rules are not so strict for those who are using the mikveh for non-Jewish law reasons. Sometime before 1920, the congregation feels a need to build an additional mikveh. And I have pictured here the additional mikveh that they put in, and it's the one I've been showing you earlier during this presentation. This mikveh was built into the changing rooms from the 1860 period. The room was only about a little over a foot wider than the mikveh itself, quite small. Remember I told you before that there was no drain in the mikveh? The way to get the water out was to bail it out by hand. But by this point, the congregation now is able to install a pump to get the water out. So here, the pump, there's a pipe that goes all the way down into the base of the mikveh to the bottom. And then it goes up to a cylindrical contraption outside of the mikveh with the spigots. I have no idea how it works. I just know it's a pump to get the water out. In November of 1933, there's a fire in the in Lloyd Street Synagogue. It was something that had to do with the furnace. Fortunately, there was not much damage done, but the congregation uses this opportunity to start a building campaign. And one of their projects was to enlarge the mikveh area. They repartitioned the southern mikveh area where the mikveh is pictured here is, and they make the secretary boardroom smaller with a plywood wall. and that also allows an entrance into the secretary's office, which then can lead to a doorway that was built sometime between 1880 and 1910 that goes into the main synagogue building. We also know at this time that changing cubicles were added in the enlarged space. And tin walls and tin partitions were added in the changing rooms and in the rest of the mikveh area. Now we're very fortunate also in our museum to have recollections about this, the mikveh from Shomer Mishmeres HaKodesh. One of the recollections comes from Sadie Sachs. She's daughter of Yehuda Mordechai Rosenfeld, who was the shamus or the watchman of Shomer Mishmeres, mostly in the 20s. And she said, referring to the men, they would use the mikveh before holidays and on Friday evening. There were also mikvahs on Lombard Street and one on Eden Street for women. And David Miller also shared his recollections. He was the son of Tobias Miller, I believe he was one of the last presidents of Shomrei during the 1950s. So David Miller says, I do know that the mikveh was definitely used by women who made use of it almost exclusively at night. The daytime was available for use by men. He also said the mikveh was used by men before davening, before praying. And the mikveh was in constant use until the late 50s. So the question is, what happened in the late 50s? In the 50s, there was another huge demographic shift in this area where the congregants are moving out of these starter homes, moving to the suburbs. So by 1858, the elders realize that they cannot maintain the building any longer and they decide to sell it. Well, in 1860, the Jewish Historical Society is formed with the sole purpose to buy this building, and they do. And their goal was to use the building for education purposes and to show and have it as a museum for the public. So I thank you this afternoon for joining me for this talk and for the story about the mikvaot of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. And I look forward for you to come back to the Jewish Museum for more stories online or hopefully in person when this pandemic is over. Now it's time, if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A and Laura will handle that for us.
Yes, thank you so much, Wendy, for such a fascinating presentation. I know I certainly learned a ton listening to it. So I'm Laura Grant. I'm the program assistant here at the JMM, and I'm here to help facilitate Q&A this afternoon. So if you have any questions for Wendy about her presentation, please go ahead and use the Q&A button, which you should see at the bottom or top of your screen, to submit your questions. And if you're joining us on Facebook, you can go ahead and use the comment field on Facebook, and our tech team will make sure that those questions are passed along to us. So I see that Helene has asked, hi Helene, thank you for joining us. When were the bricks painted pink and why were they painted pink?
The bricks were painted in 2008. And the reason they were painted that is because after more research was done, they determined that the original 1845 building was painted a pinky stone color. So they wanted the building to reflect what the museum wanted the Lloyd Street Synagogue to reflect what it looked like in 1860.
Thank you. Okay. I see Sarah has asked in the chat, could you review the Hebrew terms for cistern and the Hebrew word for bore?
Okay, the Hebrew term for the Hebrew word for a cistern is dut, and the one for the storage reservoir is bore. Hope that answers that.
Thank you. Let's see, one came in from Debbie. What were the qualifications for the mikvah ladies? I assume this is the woman who ran the mikvah. And was a man on duty at the mikvah when it was open for the men?
Okay, that question came from my sister, and she has stumped me. I do not know what the qualifications are for the mikvah ladies. And I would most definitely assume that a man was there for the men. A woman would not be involved with that during that time.
Maybe something to research. That would be interesting to know what sort of specifications or qualifications were required. Here's one from Ellen. Do we know what the charge to use the mikvah was over time? Did the fee change over time?
I have not read any information on what the fee was. I have no idea. I know today there's various fees in modern mikvah, in mikvaot, and each one is different. And some you can pay by year, some you pay per use. But I don't know what they were at that time.
What was the water source for the most recent mikvah?
It was rainwater that was gathered from the roof and went through a downspout into the bore.
I see some questions coming in the chat as well, so I'm going to go ahead and just have a look. Oh, here's a good one. What do you do when someone is in the mikvah? Are there any specific prayers or rituals for when someone is in the mikvah?
There is a prayer that you can say if you're going to the mikvah for Jewish law reasons. It follows the basic format of the many prayers that are said in Judaism, starting with Baruch Atah. And the translation for those using the mikvah is, "Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with your commandments and commanded us concerning the immersion." So that's only for people who are using the mikvah for Jewish law reasons. Mm-hmm. You can really use any prayer that has meaning for you as you go down. Now, traditionally, people immerse themselves three times, and there's different traditions on when you say the prayer when you're immersing yourself.
I like this question for today's weather with the snow. Any idea how cold the mikvah got in the pre-gas energy period? And how did people handle when the weather was bad, inclement weather?
I know that usually there is a fire hearth near the mikvah. So that would heat the room. And we also learned that water was heated on this fire hearth to add to the mikvah water to warm it. What the exact temperature was, I don't know, but I'm sure they tried to make it as comfortable as possible. And how they dealt with this bad weather, I have no idea.
Here's the question from Facebook. Would just one person go into the mikvah at a time?
For Jewish law reasons, definitely, only one at a time. But I've heard that for the non-Jewish law reasons, it doesn't matter. I've heard of men who use it daily, that they've gone in with more than one at a time.
And here's a related question. Do you have any idea how often the mikvah was used in its quote unquote heyday? And was there particular days where it was more busy, say on Fridays?
I would assume, I mean, I haven't read anything particular, but I know from my own knowledge that before the holidays and before the Sabbath, it was very busy with the men. If you noticed in one of the last slides I showed with all the changing stalls, they were installed for the men to use because they were required to use the mikvah before they prayed in the morning at the synagogue. So it was very busy at those periods. So I hope that answers the question.
And was the Lloyd Street Synagogue mikvah, was that used ever for conversion?
I don't know. I have not read one way or the other about that. So I can't answer that question. But I do know a friend of mine was asked to be a witness at a conversion at a local mikvah. And he said it was a very moving experience to be part of that experience.
See, we still have some questions coming in. Here, Helene asked, where did people bathe before the bathtubs were added?
As far as I know, there were no, no bathtubs before the 20th century there. Whether there were basins there for the people to clean in, I don't know. I've never seen any information regarding that, whether people had to clean before they left home or there were facilities to do that at the mikvah. I don't know.
Do you know how many mikvot still exist in the United States currently, or maybe any examples of some historic mikvot around the United States?
Well, there are many, because the mikvah custom, the mikvah practice is still widely practiced by many who are Orthodox. I know in Baltimore, there's a handful of mikvot. How many exist totally in the United States, I don't know. And of the historic mikvahs, I haven't read that much about other historic mikvahs in the United States. I do know that one of the first mikvahs we know of was in New York City for, I'm trying to think of the name of the synagogue. It's the first synagogue in the United States. It was started in the 1600s. And on Mill Street, there was a stream there, and the people used to use the stream for their mikvah before they built the mikvah house. But we don't know exactly where that mikvah house was. But there's still, there, most early synagogues had mikvahs attached to them. I mean, not necessarily attached to them, excuse me. The community had a mikvah. Mm-hmm. It didn't necessarily have to be part of the synagogue itself.
Here's a question from Ed. Is there any connection between baptism and the ritual of using a mikvah? So Catholic baptisms and the mikvah ritual practice.
That's a good question. Now, in the Bible, it says quite often that when people are ritually impure, they use water to purify themselves. And that's where the custom of the mikvah came from. And the baptism comes from the same source. Comes from the same source.
Thank you. Let's see. Were the mikvot in the synagogue after the Jewish Historical Society purchased the property?
Say that again, please.
Were the mikvot in the synagogue after the Jewish Historical Society purchased?
The mikvot that were built by Shomrim Mishmeres HaKodesh were in the building, yes. And they were renovated and cleaned up. And they're the ones that we see today when we go on a tour of the museum.
And I see your sister-in-law says, I always understood that there were women who immersed you, made sure you were completely underwater. Have you heard similar things?
Yes. So there are these mikvah ladies that stand there. Some are there, they, when somebody goes into the mikvah ladies often hold a towel up so they don't see the person, they give them privacy. Mm-hmm. So then people go down, and when they immerse, many times the mikvah ladies will then look just to make sure that every part of the person's body is under the water. That means you can't have any hair sticking out of the water. It has to be totally immersed. So the women will look there. I also know that some women will look to make sure that the woman is totally clean, the person is going to immerse, that there's no spare hair on their body that will prevent the mikvah water from touching that part of the skin. But often, though, they really respect people's privacy and modesty.
I think we have time for just a couple more questions. I see this one from Facebook. When and why was the original mikvah filled in and covered up?
It was filled in to make way for the new synagogue building, of the addition to the building, because the house was on the property that was needed for the expansion. So it was filled in. It was right under the part of the wall of the 1860 building is on top of where the mikvah was. So that mikvah had no functional purpose for them after the addition was put on, whereas maybe the dut did have a functional purpose. So maybe that's why it wasn't filled in.
And so you mentioned early in your presentation about some home mikvahs. So Harriet says, I remember seeing a book that had directions about how to make a home mikvah. And you said that they were built into the foundation. Do you have any more information about home mikvahs or how they were built or how they were different maybe than ones that were built for synagogues?
I have not read about that. I do not know, but from what I've read though, the mikvah, the descriptions for them, what they have to be, the requirements of them are pretty basic. They have to be big enough for somebody to be totally immersed. Some descriptions say they have to be a certain cubic size, but we don't know what a cubic really is. So it's really, there's a lot of interpretation when you decide how big it is. Most of the early mikvah were found in private homes. Mm-hmm. They were in homes. In New Hampshire, there is a site that people can visit, Strawberry Hill? Strawberry Bank, called Strawberry Bank. And in my research, I read that there was a mikvah that was found there in one of the private homes. So it's common to have it in a home.
That's really interesting. I wonder if I can go ahead and ask. I'm seeing in the comments, you know, these lovely well wishes, and it's very clear that you put so much time and research into this presentation. What sort of inspired you to research the Mikva'ot and take this, I'll say, deep dive into learning about them and the history? And maybe if you could share sort of what inspired that and maybe what was the most surprising or exciting of your finding? Mm-hmm.
Well, what inspired me, I think, was meeting Esther Doyle Reed, who the archaeologist, on one of my tours when she filled me in. And I realized that much of the information we had on the Mikva'ot, much of the information that was given to the docents for training so they could lead tours of the synagogues was, we were lacking information on the mikvah. There really wasn't that much there. So I wanted to know more. And I started this, my quest because I wanted to train the docents further in the characteristics of the mikvah. I mean, I knew from my own experience, people were asking me questions and I didn't have the answer. So to get the answers, you've got to do some digging. And that's what drove me to do this.
I think with that, I will say thank you, Wendy, so much for this such an informative and fascinating presentation. And thank you, everyone, for joining us this afternoon. I also want to thank Nancy, who introduced the program at the start, and also thank Tara Ballard, our captioner, for captioning today's event. I want to remind everyone that as you leave the program today, you're going to be directed to a survey. And if you could please just take a minute to fill that out and share your thoughts about today's event, it really does help us as we move forward with our planning process. And before we leave, we're gonna drop a couple links into the chat. So as Nancy mentioned earlier, this event is part of a series of programs that are dedicated to the 175th anniversary of the Lloyd Street Synagogue. So if you missed the kickoff event, which was in October, where we shared memories and stories related to all those years of history connected to the synagogue, you can check out the event recording via the link in chat. There's also going to be a link to an event in November that featured a dramatic retelling of arguments expressed by two Baltimore rabbis over the conflict of slavery. So you can watch that event recording via the link. And then finally, there's going to be a link to a series of blog posts that are written by our volunteers, many of whom were on the call today. So special shout out to our wonderful JMM volunteers for joining today and for contributing to this blog post series, which features the answers to questions that the volunteers typically receive from visitors about the Lloyd Street Synagogue. And there's even one that they recently did about the Mikva’ot of the Lloyd Street Synagogue, so you want to make sure that you check that out. So all those links should be in there for you, and I just want to say thank you again so much, Wendy. Thank you all for joining us, and we hope to see you back again at the virtual JMM for additional programming. Have a great rest of your afternoon, and thank you.